So welcome. I am so excited about tonight. I've been looking forward to this since we had tea. Paul Rogers with the Center for Social Entrepreneurship came back from Esalen, where Susan Collin Marks and John Marks were leading a workshop, and he was full of excitement of the possibilities. And tonight is a gathering of many sectors of George Mason University and Search for Common Ground in the world coming together for an exchange on leading change through reflective practice. This evening is sponsored by the School for Public Policy at George Mason, the Center for Social Entrepreneurship, and thanks to Paul Rogers organizing and connecting the threads for this, the Center for Consciousness and Transformation. We'll hear at the conclusion from Mark Rogers, Center for Consciousness. Paul Rogers and Mark Thurston.
We're brothers.
I'm so sorry, Mark. And this is also the first public session that is co-sponsored by the Center for Peacemaking Practice, a brand new center at George Mason. And I'm really pleased to be having the first evening with Susan Collin Marks and John Marks. And I'm also pleased to have the reflective practice class here, and particularly grateful for Jackie Antonsen's help in all of the logistical organizing and her role in this. This event is being filmed, and if anyone wants to opt out, they should see Catherine, who is smiling here next to all the computers, and there is a way to opt out. It's also being simulcast on the web for several people who weren't able to come physically but wanted to be able to hear our discussion. I also wanted to announce the Center for Consciousness and Transformation. Mark Thurston asked me to announce the Character Strengths, Leadership, Positive Psychology and Resilience Conference that is happening April 13th. There are postcards that will be out by the door, and they will give you a early bird registration discount if you register by March 19th for an April 13th all-day event. We thought that would be of interest to many of the people gathered here. So, without further ado, we're going to have introductory comments from three of our groups that are co-sponsoring tonight. And the first comments will be from Ann Baker, who is a professor and senior associate dean at the School of Public Policy. Prior to joining Mason, Dean Baker was a Kellogg Fellow, having received a three-year leadership development fellowship from the W.K. Kellogg Foundation for International Leaders of the Future. And her research interests are in cross-cultural communication, organizational change, group dynamics, conversational learning, and conflict and change. Thank you, Dean Baker.
Why don't I just stand so I can move around a little bit that way. I'm very glad to be with you. And when I think about, I think a lot of times when we hear the term reflective practice, often we think about that at the individual level, that a person engages or tries to continue intentionally to engage in reflective practice. But I think sometimes if we really want to make a difference in the world, if we're really trying to lead change, one of the things that I guess I want to emphasize is the possibility of having what I think of as communal reflective practice. Etienne Winger is one of the people who has inspired me a lot in his writing. He talks a lot about how to get people to learn from each other at a different level. And he talks about reflective practice as a combination between imagination and engagement. And that image to me is very inspiring. Because when we're engaged in a substantial kind of imagination, we are seeing things, imagining things, hearing things, considering possibilities that are really new and novel. It stretches us outside of our comfort zone. But if we do that and it doesn't really have any kind of an impact on what we do, our behavior, our actions, then it doesn't really make that much difference. And so he talks about the engagement as being like a tool that the imagination can then really land on. And I like that image a lot as well. But I think that those reflective practices require a good bit of intentionality, and especially when we're involved in a group, that if we don't intentionally help people begin practices that are different, especially in a Western culture or a US culture where action is what's often rewarded and expected, then integrating the reflection into that, especially in their workplace or in group settings, is something that not only doesn't happen, but it can be actually looked down on. People can be dismissed for what looks passive on the surface. It reminds me also of Paolo Ferrari's work, who's another person who's very much inspired me. And he talks about the need for there to be a dialogue between action and reflection. And that if we don't have that dialogue, the action becomes idle and empty because it's not informed by thinking about what the consequences of our actions are. It's not informed by really thinking deeply about where it is that we want to be going and where we've come from and what might guide us or inspire us to a different kind of action. And that when our action is not informed by reflection, it really doesn't make a difference. It doesn't involve real change that lasts. On the other hand, reflection that's not engaged in some kind of action, he talks about it just being armchair revolution, mm-hmm. or I might think of it as being armchair principles, where I have values and I have beliefs, but it doesn't really make any difference in terms of the kind of impact I might want to have. So I want to just mention those things because I think that the program that we're going to have the opportunity to really benefit from tonight comes from people who have been very much informed by those kinds of combinations which really make a difference in the world.
I now would like to introduce Greg Werkheiser, who is the inaugural managing director of the Mason Center for Social Entrepreneurship. He has formed and led social enterprises in the field of social innovation, civic education, law, government and politics, and cultural heritage preservation. He's initiated projects and worked in various ways in the fields of social innovation, civic education, law, government, etc. So lots and lots of social entrepreneurship, and I look forward to your comments.
Good evening. How is everyone? Thank you all for coming out. We appreciate you braving Northern Virginia traffic. Nothing provides the time and space for reflective thought like sitting in Northern Virginia traffic. So all of you should be very wise after several years of suffering through it. And we appreciate you coming down to the Commonwealth of Virginia from DuPont Circle and civilization. If you've been following political developments in Virginia recently, you'll know that Virginia as a whole could use a lot more time for reflective practice, especially down in Richmond. That's the end of my same partisan comments. I'd like to thank you for letting the Center for Social Entrepreneurship be involved as a partner this evening, and my mom would also like to thank you, because for many years before getting into the social entrepreneurship deal, I was a commercial litigator, and so they paid me very well not to resolve conflict, but to evolve conflict. My job was a good day if I could make like grown men cry on the stand. And so hanging out with folks who are interested in peacemaking and conflict resolution and consciousness and transformation has me on a short path to save my soul. And so I thank you, my mother thanks you, my wife, my child thanks you for allowing me to hang out with you this evening. Give me 30 seconds to explain what the Center for Social Entrepreneurship does so that I can give you a little bit greater context for the brief comments I want to make before we get to the folks who are going to be speaking this evening. So the center is about a year old. It does three things. We focus on young people who are at that part of the transition from folks who are curious about ways in which to change the world to folks who have a business plan and a strategy, right? So we catch them during their student years, and we try and surround them with educational programs, inspirational programs, incubation programs that help them on their journey to be folks who can transform their idea into something that actually improves the lives of real people on the ground facing real challenges around the world. So it's been about a year, but Mason had a bunch of stuff going on in that field before it created this center, and the center itself is part of a staged merger with a seven-year-old nonprofit organization with which I was involved. So even though the center is new, the work that the center is doing is about 7 years old, and that puts Mason in a good spot relative to other universities, not that everything's about competition, but relative to other universities in this space in terms of being a leader in the field. And I'll just give you two examples of programs that you can get your head around to understand what we do. So today, George Mason approved the launch this fall of a master's program in social entrepreneurship, which will be an awesome development and give folks both internal to the university and prospective students a reason to come to Mason and to pursue that. And my faculty director and colleague, Paul Rogers, really led that effort over the last couple of months, and it's exciting, and I thank you for your work. So if any of you out there are interested in potentially becoming a master's student, you should see Paul, because he loves nothing more than to take business cards and hook people up with stuff. And then the other program, as an example, is we run a six-week summer institute. This will be the seventh year we run it, called the Social Innovation Program, where we take 25 to 30 of the smartest undergraduate and graduate students we can find from around the world, bring them together, and over those 6 weeks, expose them to 25 guest lecturers who are the types of folks that we're hearing from this evening, real thought leaders and practitioners in the world trying to take these kind of concepts of positive social change and put them into practice in the real world. So if you know an undergraduate or a recent grad who might be good for that, please send them our way. In the master's program and in the summer program, we have growing elements that focus on the subject matter that we're gonna be talking about this evening. The concept of being reflective as a social entrepreneur is something you think would be natural, right? The very people who are self-aware enough to look out at the world and see the role that they can play in changing something are the folks who you would think would take the time and think about what's their place in the world. And the very nature of being an entrepreneur, a social entrepreneur, is you're theoretically inventing a solution to a problem, right? And because you're inventing it, every day that you're a social entrepreneur, you're reinventing it, because you're going through the process of learning about what works and what doesn't work. But the irony is that the first thing that gets sacrificed among emerging social entrepreneurs is the time they dedicate to stepping back and reflecting on what's happening to them and what their impact is in the world. You get into the excitement, you're out raising money, you're networking, you're launching programs, that's where the excitement is. And the thing that is the first thing to go, but is in essence among the most important things you could do to move your organization forward, is creating time and space to think about how is this impacting me, and just as importantly, how is this impacting the world. So when we think about reflection, we frequently think about an internal analysis, but it's equally important to look at data from the rest of the world and step back. We're guilty of that even at the center. So we spent 4 hours today for the first time in months gathering up our own team and asking, what impact are we having? Right? Ultimately, stepping back from the day-to-day triage that goes with being an emerging entrepreneur and asking the more fundamental questions. So thank you all for allowing us to participate. Welcome. Great to have you on campus, and look forward to exploring ways that we can continue to collaborate. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Greg. And now it's a pleasure to introduce the Dean Andrea Bartoli, who is a senior fellow at the Center for Peacemaking Practice, as well as our the Dean and here in the School of Conflict Analysis and Resolution. He's also the Drucey French Cumbie Chair of Conflict Resolution. He was founding director of Columbia University's Center for International Conflict Resolution, a senior scholar at the School of International and Public Affairs, a teaching fellow at Georgetown University and the University of Siena, a member of the community of San Egidio, and board member of Search for Common Ground. Andrea.
Nice to be here and nice to follow Susan. It's always nice to have somebody leading you and leading me here. To see good friends, welcome. Delighted to be here. But also leading in an exploration. And when I asked Susan, what do I need to say? What is the role? What do I need to do? She said, well, you know, we are framing things. So frames are interesting things, you know. You put a frame around a face, or you put a frame around. But I think that it has actually to do more with reflective practice. And the way I want to get into that, knowing that I'm not speaking as a dean, I'm speaking as myself, is to tell a story that actually John told me many years ago of three men that were doing the same thing. They were all carving stones. And a visitor came talking to them, asking, what are you doing? And the first one said, they forced me to. I'm a slave, I'm working, I'm here, I'm doing what I'm doing, I'm carving stones. So they went to the second one and said, what are you doing? They were doing exactly the same thing. And he said, I'm earning my living. I have my salary at the end of this, and I have my family. Went to the third one, and he said, I'm building cathedrals. And I thought about it because I think that the same things can mean a lot of different things, depending on how you reflect on what the thing is. And as we know very well, growing in our capacity to understand what the thing is actually a gift. It's a gift to those who are able to have the gift of understanding, but it's also a gift to the others who can look and then say, oh, nice. A little bit like an artist that paints a wonderful Gioconda, and then everybody goes to the Louvre and say, oh, it's a nice Gioconda. It's a lovely piece. It's something that I can see because you saw it before me. And so when I'm thinking about frames and reflective practice, I see, in a way, the master of all. And I think of Genesis, chapter 1. When the Almighty created light and saw that it was good. The Almighty is reflecting. It's not enough to do. There is a need to think back and look back and say, is it really good? Is it really what I think it is? Is it really what I think it is that is good? And then goes on for 6 days, and every day does the same. He creates the water and the sky and the moon and the sun and the plants and the fish and life and everything. And every day, at the end of the day, the Almighty says, let me look at it. Let me have a sense of it. I need to be part of this because whatever it is, I want to understand it. The moment is beyond me, it is an invitation for me to see it and understand that it's good. What makes something good good is not only the doing, is also the caring back enough to go back and look and say that is it indeed good. So, in a world in which many are justified simply because they have good intention, I saw John and Susan leading many others to do things with these questions as their frame. I'm trying to do this, I'm trying to make sense of things, but is what I'm doing really good? And I think that the extraordinary growth of search is in part linked to this capacity to say, well, sometimes it's not that good, or it could be better. Or we did it here this way, can we do it here that way? Or what should we change for making something that makes sense? And that gets me to another point that has to do with the fact that any piecework has to do with creation. That any piecework is not going to work at all unless it has a component that is creative in nature, simply because no human experience is the same. You always need to create something that is responsive to the moment, to the actual people that are there. And clearly, that's a responsibility. So you do need to go back and say, oh, did I do it right? Is what I did good? Does anybody agree or disagree that what I'm doing is actually good or not good? So the reflective practice is an essential component of making this world good or better than it was before this creation started. The other day I was at Point of View, this wonderful retreat center that Eska has in Lorton. And in working with Susanna and with Mark and others, a word came to me. I'm Italian, I don't speak English, I'm struggling with my expression, but there was this word, homeness. Being at home, the quality of being at home, as something that has to do with the discovery that for each of us, to be home is part of being whole, that being home is part of being human. And so I see tonight as a way of a beginning of a gift in which by reflecting on the practice that we all share, we are actually inviting each other home to this little planet that is floating around in little places where we are simply learning how to build cathedrals out of our carving stones. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea. And now, John Marks is founder and president of Search for Common Ground and Common Ground Productions. He wrote and produced The Shape of the Future, a TV documentary series that was simulcast on Israeli, Palestinian, and Arab satellite TV. He also works on numerous other TV and radio programs. He has an honorary doctorate from the University of Peace in Costa Rica, and is an award-winning author and senior Ashoka Fellow. And Susan Colin Marks is the senior vice president of Search for Common Ground, a native of South Africa, worked as a peace builder during transition from apartheid to democracy, facilitated dialogues for many decades, and has done one-on-one coaching for political, institutional, civil society leaders worldwide. She launched the Leadership Wisdom Initiative at Search for Common Ground, which I have very much enjoyed getting to know in bits and pieces in our conversations. She was a Jennings Randolph Fellow at the U.S. Institute of Peace, an Institute for Noetic Sciences Creative Altruism Award winner, Skoll Fellowship for Social Entrepreneurship, and also an honorary doctorate from the University of Peace in Costa Rica. Thank you both for being here tonight.
Well, hello everybody.
Hello.
I don't quite know what to do with this barrier, so I'm going to walk around. We probably both will. So greetings to all of you, and both of us actually want to start off by saying how completely thrilled we are about this evening. It's an evening of moon and butterflies and stars and cool winds, because it's the first time that we've ever been invited to speak with the disciplines underpinning our talk that are the fundamental building blocks of what Search for Common Ground is. Nobody's ever recognized that before. And so the social entrepreneurship, which is at the soul of Search, the conflict transformation, which is what we're doing out there, the consciousness is the place that we come from. These are the threads that hold us together and take us forward. And we want to thank you for recognizing it. This sense of intuition and synchronicity and connection is so powerful. I can feel this room bursting. So we both want to say that we're so entirely entranced by what you've actually done for us here. So.
I want to say something just to start to my friend Andrea Bartoli. First, that story he told came through me from Abdulaziz Said at American University. And I've been using it for years, and now he's taken my best lines. So together we can build cathedrals. This evening, for me, is hugely special because of what we're talking here is the synthesis of the three. I've known Andrea for, 20-odd years, and I've been interacting with ICAR, or now CSCAR. I can't pronounce it. I've been interacting with it for 15 years, and every few years they invite me to come over and give a class or something like that. And what I realized today, actually, in thinking it through, was ICAR is necessary but not sufficient. In other words, conflict resolution, conflict transformation, which is a skill and a technique of working, is only part of the answer. And the reason search has been successful is we're social entrepreneurs that have been able to apply conflict resolution in the world, and we come from a consciousness base. We come from an expanded consciousness. I got many of the sort of thoughts that allowed me to become transformational, if you will, and search to be a transformational organization through things that had absolutely nothing to do with conflict resolution or even social entrepreneurship. In fact, I was about 10 years into my work, and I had a high school classmate, a guy named Bill Drayton, who started Ashoka, so Arlington being the center of social entrepreneurship as well as conflict resolution, or at least Northern Virginia. And Bill told me about I was a social entrepreneur. And it was like the old line that Molière had said, he'd been speaking prose his whole life and never realized it. Well, I had been a social entrepreneur for at least 10 years, but at least now I had a phrase that I could use on airplanes. What do you do? Oh, I try not to talk to anyone on airplanes. But this notion of a synthesis, I think you should merge all three of your centers, and with Susan being the MC, presumably. Because I think there's something really important. When I started my work, I remember we talked to a lawyer in California who was doing a lot of mediation being a way of doing conflict resolution, clearly. And he said, this field can go in two ways, and these words stayed with me for a huge amount of time. This field can go in two ways. It can become a way of increasing law firm billings, which is the way, if you will, I think a large percentage of the field practices the field, or it can become a new way of thinking. And we try to be in the new way of thinking way. We see it as a transformational technology, a transformational methodology that can take it beyond, if you will, it could shift the world in a transformational way from an adversarial to a non-adversarial place, from a win-lose to a win-win kind of place. And that's all we do. I mean, I can give you all our trade secrets in about 10 minutes. And you can study for a couple of years and get a master's in those kinds of things. But the trick is being able to apply them. And we're applied transformationalists. That's what we try to be. A pure transformationalist is wonderful if you want to start a new religion or you want to write a philosophy textbook. But if you're going to be engaged in the world, you need to be an applied transformationalist, well, I think. And so that's where we're coming from in starting us. So, without further ado, the line I was also going to tell you, if you really want to get into reflective practice, marry it.
So we're going to be going back and forth all the time this evening, and So please don't applaud us each time, because we you know, we get embarrassed. So,
yeah, it's an applause. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I think we should keep going.
So what we've been trying to say is thank you for this beautiful invitation. We just took a bit of a long way to say that. So I'd like to introduce you a little bit to Search for Common Ground. Every morning, 425 of our colleagues get up in 30 countries around the world, in a number of continents, from 45 different nationalities, and they go out into the world to be common grounders, to work for common ground, to search for common ground. We've expanded from an idea that John had 30 years ago. This is, in fact, this month is our 30th birthday. That we can applaud. So our mission is to transform the way the world deals with conflict away from adversarial responses towards cooperative solutions. And it's really as simple as that, and we have many ways of doing that. Our core idiom that we use, metaphor that we use, is understand the differences, act on the commonalities. And that's really it. We can sort of go home now. From that, though, what we have learned, what we've discovered, is that every single thing that we can think of can be done within a common ground frame. And that it's possible, therefore, for us to work with whatever is, work with what is, in any society, in any place in the world, because, of course, we're always working. Our employees are the local people, always from the different sides of the conflict. And we can fit with and be a part of whatever is going on politically, culturally, and so on, because we are able to apply, as John said, this idea, the foundations of the common ground approach to anything. So we work through sport, we work through music, we work through the media tremendously. We work with different groups of people who are professionals. We work with social entrepreneurs. We do leadership, we do trainings of all different sorts, we do community organizing. We, of course, are mediators and negotiators, and the list goes on and on. And this is the core of search, is that sense of finding our feet in the places that our feet have taken us, and then working with what is, rather than coming from outside and saying, this is what has to happen here. And so the theme that you're going to hear throughout this evening is the sense of this organic gathering, this organic reflection of the events, the experiences that we have, becoming a part of who we are. And then that feeds back in, and then more and more. And so we have this feedback loop that is Search for Common Ground. We're going to follow some particular threads this evening, and John's going to start with one of those threads.
Okay. I also want to tell you that half of the way we do our applied work is we produce television and radio and internet stuff. So we're going to go back and forth between speaking and showing you stuff. And from a pedagogical point of view, it's my impression that people have about a 10-minute tolerance for a lecture, or for people talking and then they lose it, or they wander. And we find by going back and forth and actually showing you pictures and playing sounds, people stay with it longer. And usually they remember the stuff on the screen more than they remember what we say. Or not always, it depends on the individual. But doing it all, mixing them up, from my perspective and from our perspective as an organization, is a better way of doing it than sticking only to one way of communicating. And it hits different people a different way. There's no uniformity on this. Anyway, that's my rationalization why I'm going to show you a lot of video. but I'm going to start talking about Iran. And here's something that has some reflective practice in it. We've been thinking about it for 16, 17 years. And we're going to lead you through a progression and show you a few things that came out of it. And I'm gonna stop about 6 months ago, so I'm not gonna take you up to the present, which is a question of some interest to most of us, what's going on. It starts about almost 20 years ago. We, as an organization, were bringing people together from across the Middle East, Israelis, Palestinians, Saudis, Moroccans, Egyptians, and stuff. And it was hugely exciting stuff, because back in those days, that wasn't going on. Now it's become more commonplace and they've moved on. But at that time, it was just unbelievably exciting to be in a room with a Saudi and an Israeli. Didn't have to say anything, just to be in the same room. And there was the Iranians were in this. And one of the Iranian participants was the former ambassador of the United Nations. And we tried to deal with high-level people who were not in places of power, but were in a position that they had the phone number of somebody, and if something interesting were to come up, they could be in touch. And that's how you try to do this track two kind of work that we do, mostly, mainly. I mean, not mainly we do track two, but we do a lot of track two. And this ambassador came up to me after he'd been to two or three of our Middle Eastern meetings. He said, you know, we should do this between the U.S. and Iran. And frankly, at the time, I didn't think that was the greatest idea. I got a little afraid, if you will. I mean, not really. It took me about a year to get it. And a year later, we organized a whole set of meetings between Americans and Iranians at a high level. And it was highly secret. It was so secret in the organization that only about three of us knew about it. And it became less of a secret. Now you'll understand why. So I can talk to you about these top secret kinds of things. And if you're going to do meetings with Iranians, you better have somebody who can give you visas. You can't just sort of meet in a hotel in London, because they're not going to get into the airport. And so we got a Scandinavian country who we'd worked with before, I think Sweden. And we talked to them at a high level, will you sponsor this? And they were a little wary, so we had to get the State Department and the Clinton administration to say that they thought it was a good idea, which we were able to arrange. You know, we didn't know that was going to be a barrier, but getting through barriers is part of this kind of work. So we had five meetings in Sweden between these high level of Americans and Swedes. And the facilitator, who we called the South African, which she was, so she didn't have to be either an American or an Iranian, was Susan, who happens to be, you know, we complement each other, you may have noticed that, and Susan is an absolutely brilliant facilitator, to the point she can do things that are just unbelievable, and I don't have those kinds of skills, and I'm more of an entrepreneur of conflict transformation than a practitioner. She's a practitioner. So let me have her explain to you how she got, what she did with these Iranians and Americans, who presumably were not an easy job. Assistant secretaries of state, former ambassadors to the UN, I mean, high level kinds of people.
I had just come from South Africa. I came over to the States in 1994 to marry this man. And so that's how I got to be here. And I'm still an American and a South African, and I have one or two other nationalities, but that's another story. And so I had just been a part of the South African peace process. And what we had been doing was talking. What we had been doing was reconciling. What we'd been doing was finding a way to connect with each other after decades of deep division and appalling conflict. And we discovered that we didn't really know how to do that. And in the end, we did what Machado said. We made that road by walking. We just, every day, took a step and discovered whether it worked or it didn't. And a lot didn't, and some did. And so we built our practice in that way. And we found that dialogue was a key tool. We would talk for hours and hours. I was facilitating many of those talks across very many different sectors in South Africa. And in the course of that, I began to understand that while dialogue is a tool, and a very, very valuable tool, who we are and what we're becoming in the process of dialogue is the deeper side of this. This is where things begin to shift. This is where, when we bring our full selves into that dialogue, as facilitator, as participant, that we begin to make the transformation. It has to be a part of all of us. We're all in it together. I had come from the raw experience of being on the streets in South Africa, dodging bullets and tear gas, and being in the middle of it all, mediating on the spot in the street.
She's the only mediator I know who was shot while mediating. We're doing it, and it's a higher standard, let's say, than most of us work with in this country.
John likes that story much more than I do.
He's a boy.
He's a boy, exactly. Yeah. Thank you. Very good boy. What are we going to do with this? And so what I have always learned is it has come from raw experience. That's been a continuation in my life. But and as the years have gone by, that's been then combined with learning other skills and bringing them back, creating a container to bring that back to others. And I want to share with you three things that I learned because they directly impact on those Swedish meetings. The one is that, and some of them you know really well, but I want to say them again, that we have to be peace. You can't go out there and say we have to have peace. We have to do this in our own lives. None of us will ever manage to be that. We have, my own sense is that having the intention to build our own ability to be that peace and falling off as I do every day, again and again and again, I fail miserably and I come back. That's what I've learned, is I cycle back and continue to have that intention of being the peace, because I cannot ask for peace out there in the world unless I'm willing to do it in here. And the being peace becomes one of the vehicles for holding the fear which results in hatred and transforming that into a sense of oneness. And we in South Africa had to move from black and white, from right and left, from all the different isms that we had, into saying we're all South Africans. Later, when we worked in Burundi, I remember having a conversation with the Minister of Human Rights and saying to him, how are you doing? This was some years ago. How are you doing this? He said, well, I have a problem. All the Hutus want rights for Hutus and all the Tutsis want rights for Tutsis. And I said, what do you want? He said, I want rights for all Burundians. And I said, well, in that case, we can work together, and we did. The second learning was that we can support others to make that peace, to find that peace within their own hearts. Rolf Meyer, who was the chief negotiator for the apartheid government and worked with Cyril Ramaphosa, who was the chief negotiator for the ANC, became so close that they felt that they could resolve any problem. And Rolf wrote a seminal paper, which I have online if anybody wants it. I have it in Swahili as well, if that's useful. He wrote a seminal paper in which it's about 40 or 50 pages long. But he says, actually, there's one lesson, and it's this long. And he said, the one lesson from moving from pragmatic leadership to the transformational leadership that allowed South Africa to do its transition was a change of mindset. And when we change our mindsets, we can change our hearts, which allows us to change our mind, which allows us to change our heart. You get the picture? The two have always gone together, and they do go together and allow that deep, deep, deep transformation. And we can support that in our work as peacemakers, peace builders, common grounders, social entrepreneurs for peace. And the third is that relationship is the language of life. And that when we have relationship, anything is possible. We're all interconnected. And when we're out of relationship, we can't move. When we're in relationship, we can. And we can create that. We can actually build relationship consciously in our own lives and in the world around us. And we can build that connection. So in Sweden, all of these things were coming into play. Here we had Iranians and Americans, very high level, who all sat in the room, their body language in the beginning, as is always in these cases, body language is extremely important and tells you a huge amount. And so the body language in the beginning was, are you demonstrating for me?
Yeah.
Legs, yes, as well. And that's always so. And within the first day, we moved out of that. We did this in a couple of ways. We chose a place which was in nature, it was on a lake, and people in the breaks would go out and walk around that lake. In South Africa, we had what we call bosberaads. It was one of the reasons that South Africa actually made the transition, is that the leaders went out and sat under the stars around a fire and drank brandy and coffee and resolved South Africa's future. And this was a Swedish form of bosberaad. We had to build confidence in the facilitating team. And so although I was the facilitator, I had sitting next to me the entire time a Lebanese security expert who they were very well known, who everybody knew, the Iranians knew. And so the fact that he sat with me and was always at my side meant that the Iranians felt that
he was half Iranian and he spoke Persian.
Right. But they felt that he was representing them and that he had their back. And then in the breaks, he would go off and walk with them and come back. And so that confidence in the team. The main thing that we were doing was to transform the relationship. This is the core of our work, by the way. Another core, got a few. From the two sides seeing each other as the problem and attacking each other as the problem, to sitting together, shoulder to shoulder, and putting the U.S.-Iranian relationship before them and facing it as a common problem. And by the end of the five meetings that we had developed a complete framework for the resolution of the Iranian-U.S. conflict. It was perfect. The problem was that when the parties got back, they couldn't sell it mm-hmm. back into their own constituencies. You know this thing called re-entry? Mm-hmm. There we had it, but it still lives to some extent to this day. But I want to hand back to John, because at that fifth meeting, there was a game changer.
So there was a huge frustration. Here we had been beautifully facilitated into coming up with the ideal agreement, the unified agreement for how to deal with the American-Iranian relations, which still would work very well today in some way. And as Susan said, neither side could sell it when they got back home. And so there was a lot of frustration in the group because the group had been very successful. And we had a high level group. We weren't talking just about people who were all things. These were people who were very much involved in politics. And at this point, one of the Iranians said, maybe we should try something else. Maybe we should try something new here. He said, there haven't been any Americans in Tehran for the last, 1998, almost 20 years, since the Iranian hostage thing and the American embassy being seized. He said, maybe it's time to bring Americans back openly to Tehran. And he said, that sounds like a good idea to me. How do we do that? He said, any Americans that come will be criticized heavily because they're Americans. He said, so let's do something something that's easier. He said, bring wrestlers. Oh, it hadn't been very high on my list. In other words, I never thought that. Yeah, but the logic of it is that in Iran, wrestlers are kind of the samurai, the great legends of Iran are about wrestlers. There's sagas, and it's still the most popular sport with the masses. So, you know, I'm a social entrepreneur. I came back to the United States. I found a way to get in touch with USA Wrestling, which I had never had any contact with before. And within 2 months, I was on a plane with the American National Wrestling Team going to Tehran. And I had credentials which said I was official. But not official like I had been in the State Department, official in the sense of 1, 2, 3. I'm flexible. And that's part of being a social entrepreneur too. So we got to Tehran And it was an unbelievably move. This is 1998. It was an extraordinary circumstance. Hademy had just been elected. That made this work better. It hadn't been where we started, but when we got into it, Hademy had just been elected. We were together in a stadium, and there were like 15,000 people there, and they cheered wildly for the Americans. The American flag, we hadn't thought about the, you know, I have to tell you, when you do the kind of work that we do, the unanticipated, the unexpected results are often more interesting, or at least as interesting as the stuff you want to have happen. And what had happened with the flag is about 2 weeks before we were to go, the guy from USA Wrestling calls me up and he says, what do we do about the American flag? I don't know. What do you usually do? I mean, good conflict resolution answer. Yeah. What do you usually do? He said, "Well, we bring it and we display it in the in before me. That's how you do these kind of things. That's how sporting events work." I said, "Fine, bring it." And it's not the issue we're around. So if they don't want us to unfurl it, we won't unfurl it. But they did. And so what happened is, big, strong American wrestlers marched into the stadium carrying the American flag. And it was the first time the American flag had been exhibited openly in Tehran for 20 years, 19 years at the time. And let's just say the world's media picked up on it. Because when you think, if I give you two words, or two phrases, American flag and Tehran, what do you get?
Burn it.
Exactly. America held hostage. All that kind of stuff. I mean, the image totally is of the flag being desecrated. And we brought the flag back to Tehran. Now, you know, this is what we would call in our field reframing. We were reframing, we thought, the imagery for the world, except we didn't know this is what we were going to be doing. That's the beauty. And I always think is that if you do good work, good things happen, and good stuff follows. And this is a good example of it. And that became the symbol. So we're in every newspaper and TV station in the world is calling it, and they called it wrestling diplomacy. Now, one reason they called it wrestling diplomacy is we told them it was called wrestling diplomacy. You have a good name, it helps things along. And that one worked pretty well. So we did wrestling diplomacy, and let me go to the tape. I'll show you now what some of the media coverage looked like.
So what did two presidents in Washington and Tehran do when they want better relations or are afraid the effort could blow up in their face? Well, they moved carefully, and they turned not necessarily to diplomats, but rather to private individuals who hold no official position. At this week's conference, Iranian and American diplomats spoke in generalities. But it is someone like John Marks who is actually doing something. Marks organized a visit of American wrestlers to Iran in February. It was the first time the American flag had been displayed there since 1979.
We brought the American flag back to Tehran and with honor but without chauvinism and an atmosphere of mutual respect. What we can do is help to change the atmosphere, we can change the climate, we can produce some of the openings, but if the governments aren't interested, nothing's going to happen in the end.
But the two governments are interested. 16 Iranian wrestlers will take part in the tournament in Oklahoma this weekend as the two countries feel each other out as they move closer together. Garrick Utley, CNN.
Okay, so when we got back, President Clinton had us to the Oval Office and the wrestling team and a couple of us from Surge, and they used it to send a signal to the Iranians, and it was televised by the Voice of America came, they took photos, we went out to the Iranians, and the White House spokesman said, we're doing this and the president is behind it because we're interested in finding ways to have better relations. Now, if you do what we do, that's as good as it gets. You know, that's why we do our work. As I said on the thing, we can't make peace. Only governments can make peace, but we can create openings, we can make things happen, and that's what we did here. And it was fabulous, except it didn't work in the end. Because, and I could go into the reasons it fell all apart. And we at Search for Common Ground were faced with a problem then. Our most secret program was suddenly in every newspaper of the world. What we thought we had been doing really confidentially no longer was confidential. So we adopted what we call the two-track strategy. The first is we continued to openly do exchanges with Iran, between the US and Iran, and we did them in a high-profile kind of way. We had a couple of film summits, because the Iranians are great filmmakers, and we went to Cannes a couple of times. Somebody had to do it for your sins. We went to Cannes and we had American-Iranian film summits. We brought their films over and their filmmakers here, and we sent some of our filmmakers over there. We got an Inconvenient Truth played in Tehran, and we were trying to make it. And you know, we thought that was kind of could have a dual purpose, if you will. We did a lot of exchanges between environmentalists. The climate of Tehran and the pollution questions, just like LA, you got mountains all around and a lot of pollution, except it's much worse. And we did those kind of things. And at the same time, we maintained the back channel stuff. In other words, we had a retired American ambassador named Bill Miller, who used to be chief of staff of the Senate Intelligence Committee. He went to work for us about 10 years ago, and he maintained the kinds of contacts that we had been working with on a high level. And he still, to this day, talks an awful lot. It's unfortunate that he's about the main channel between the US and Iran at this point, because the governments are doing so badly. I'm told in the last 4 years they've had 45 minutes of conversations. That may be a bit exaggerated, but they're not doing very well together. They're not talking to each other with anything like the respect you need to talk to each other, particularly with Iranians. If you want to do anything, try doing it without respecting them. Making demands is not the way in that culture you're ever going to get anything accomplished. It's not in most cultures, but in that culture in particular. In any case, so for the next 10 years, we had our open track and our secret track, if you will. And so Bill, when the hikers got seized, remember the American hikers who wandered over the border from Iraq? Bill started to do a lot to try to get them out. And that he was using the contacts that we had in order to try to move things forward. And at this point, I sometimes back up and give you a general principle. This is what I would call the Woody Allen principle, okay? And that means, if you know the line from Annie Hall, 80% of success is showing up. And if you're gonna do the work that we're doing, you have to keep showing up. You have to do it time after time. The idea that you can parachute into a conflict and do something and then be back teaching your course on Monday morning is probably a fallacious idea. And Bill has been doing this work for a dozen years. We've been involved with the Iranians for 15 years. And because we had those contacts, we were able to do something. So I'm going to go back to the videotape now.
For 15 years, Search for Common Ground has been trying to improve relations between the United States and Iran. Search's Iran team is led by retired Ambassador Bill Miller, who is in frequent, unofficial contact with high-level Iranians. After three American hikers were jailed in Iran, Ambassador Miller held repeated meetings to have them freed. In September, he arranged for Cardinal Theodore McCarrick and Bishop John Chain to travel to Tehran, where they met religious leaders and President Ahmadinejad. This trip played a key part in freeing the hikers.
So the men are now back with their families. Talk a little bit about the highs and lows of your involvement in trying to win their release over the last couple of years.
Well, when they were taken, the families, particularly the mothers, came to us at Search for Common Ground, as well as to the Cardinal and the Bishop and their cathedrals for help in obtaining the release. They knew that that I had contact with the ambassador of Iran in New York, and we discussed the issues that might lead to their release.
Did you ever think that you would see this day?
Yes, I had every reason to believe that it would happen.
So what I got from that is about every 13 years we do something. But you had to have the intervening 13 years, and if you couldn't have it, and unfortunately most funders don't understand that. But in this case, we've been able to maintain the funding to keep the program going. And we're very grateful for that. So I'm now switching sides. I'm going to This is a highly scripted performance. Let's see. And Search, as I said before, does a lot of TV and radio production. We started, you know, thinking workshops were really a great place to do things. I had worked for Roger Fisher, problem-solving workshops. But what I noticed is you might be communicating with 25 people if it was a big workshop, and I wanted to change the world. And I didn't notice I could get enough people into the room to change the world. Now, you can do great things with workshops. I do them myself. I'm not putting down workshops. But I'd also used to write books for a living. And ABC made my last book into a documentary. And about, I think, 4 million people saw that documentary, which I noticed was about 3,970,000 more than Reddit. And I was impressed. So anyway, from the very beginning, we set up what was called Common Ground Productions. And Common Ground Productions actually started when I went to a card maker and I said, I'm president of Common Ground Productions, can you give me a card? And people who make cards don't ask for credentials. They don't ask you to prove it, you just give them the $25 or whatever it costs and they give you the card. And that was my declaration that Common Ground Productions started and existed. And within about 2 years, we had our first series on American public television, and we were in business, and we're moving forward. But I think that first declaration of having the cards made was a very important part of the whole business. In any case, we now, I'd say about half the work we do in the world is production of TV and radio. We have radio studios in 8 countries right now, and we're making in 17 different countries a soap opera, a drama series called The Team. And I think soap opera is the best medium means for reaching large audiences, drama. And for those of you who are doubting it, think of All in the Family and Archie Bunker. Probably nothing did more to change American attitudes towards bigotry than Archie Bunker. At least I don't know anything more. I mean, there are other things going on, but for popular attitudes, we make what we call soap operas for social change. And let me change the tape. And so the idea of this drama, it's called The Team, and it's about a fictional soccer team in whatever country we're working in. And I say each country version is different, and we're doing it in 17 countries. And on that soccer team, 11 players clearly, they represent whatever the conflict is. So in Kenya, they're all from different tribes. In Cote d'Ivoire, Ivory Coast, they're Muslim and Christians, and Northerners and Southerners. In Morocco, they're rich and poor, urban and rural. And in DRC, Congo, it's actually all girls, and the big problem is preventing sexual violence against women. So we use it as a platform to deal with social issues, but always within the framework, within the context of a team, of coming together. And the core metaphor is very simple. If they don't cooperate, then they lose. They don't score goals. And that's the same for countries as well as for teams. And then you're just doing drama about people and stuff like that. So I'm going to show you a 2-minute trailer, which will give you the sense See, but that's not the right video. No. Ninja Toot, I don't do.
Team is in my days of the life, you know. So many athletes here. You're a team boss here. You're a boss here, life. This is pretty tasty, also, this time.
The place where we've been making the team the longest is in Kenya. We're going into our fourth season. We've been really working with the tearing apart of Kenya since the violence. And our team there, the actors, the production crews, everybody have actually come together and are now working for a way of knitting together Kenya. We had an evaluation done there, and the stories that came out were, to us, so moving, and I want to tell you just a couple of those, because we hadn't heard all the stories of the impact of the team. Because we don't just show the team on television. We also take it out all over the country through mobile cinemas, and you too, for $5,000, can have a huge screen and a projector and a generator. And that means this can be taken anywhere. And so this, we trained community facilitators, and the community facilitators, sometimes members of the cast, go out all over the country and spend a lot of time with people. Sometimes the series gets shown for about 6 weeks, two or three episodes at a time. People come regularly, and over that time, the impact happens. And one story that came out of the evaluation when Amr Abdullah from the University of Peace, some of you will know him, he used to be here, went and with a team of others to do this evaluation, and they met with a woman who told this story. She said, when the violence happened after the election, she had to flee her home. She had to flee her village and her community. She had a new baby. The baby was 2 months old. And she went to an IDP camp, and the baby got very sick, so she went to the local medical facility. The intake nurse was from another tribe and refused her admittance with this sick baby. And so the woman went away and had no means to get to another medical facility, and the baby died. And she was devastated and in deep grief when she happened to stumble upon a mobile cinema. How these things happen, who knows, that we were doing somewhere in the country. And she went to a whole series of showings and conversations. And she realized that for her own healing and for the community that she loved, her beloved country, that she needed to do something about what had happened. And so she went and found that intake nurse. And she took her to some of these mobile cinema viewings. And over that period of time, they reconciled, and the woman forgave the intake nurse, and the intake nurse said, I will never do this again, and not only that, I'm going to do everything I can to make sure it doesn't happen to anybody else. Mm-hmm. And so the two of them became this team that went out to work with other medical facilities, intake nurses, and so on. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, you know, I've told that story, and each time I was like, it's not going to happen. But it moves me so deeply. And on another level, a wonderful story, because we have the stories of people forgiving the killers who killed their brother, their child, their parents, through just finding that there's another way of viewing this conflict. We've had people apologizing, and apologizing so deeply that the people they're apologizing to are saying, this can't be real. And then with time, discovering that it is a real apology and being able to offer forgiveness. There was a gang that was terrorizing Kibera, which is a large slum on the outskirts of Nairobi. It's one of the biggest in Africa. And this gang had been stealing cell phones, and people were afraid to, and handbags and packages. And they had actually, within their own gang, the one group had killed and had killed some members, but had also chased away some other members through all the violence. And they, the citizens of Kibera felt very, very, very unsafe. Again, they went to a series of these mobile cinemas, and they decided to no longer be a gang. Oh, they first of all decided to reconcile, and they brought back all the remaining members together, and they reconciled. They decided to now become a local NGO, if you like, and they decided that they would serve the community, which they do with lavatories, chickens, and water, which is fabulous. It's exactly what's needed. The transformation from thugs to people thinking about what's needed here most to lavatories is, to me, one of the most stunning and wonderful stories. So these are the kinds of anecdotal stories that we have, and we also, of course, have all the statistics and so on. I love the stories and wanted to just share with you a little bit of the human impact on this, of this, that is beyond the viewing on television. We're in the top ratings. We're always in the top 10. This is a very sophisticated media market, very sophisticated television market. Kenya is a hugely thriving and vibrant place, and we've even been as high as 3 in the ratings, which we're very proud of. Oh, it's me next as well. So we have been working in the DRC. I was thinking about it, in fact, just recently, because I led the team that opened up our work in the DRC. We started in July 2001, and 9/11 happened. And we thought, everyone thought, well, that's the end of that. And I said, no. And we all said, no. This is exactly what we need to be doing. I think so many of us had that response around 9/11, that what we need to do is to keep going, to keep creating, to keep transforming as best we can. So we started a program initially with offices in Kinshasa and in Bukavu, in the east and in the west. Now we have, it's our biggest program at Search for Common Ground, and we are working particularly in the East with the abuse of women and the rape of women. And the way we're doing this is through the power of the media, and by working with the military. And there are two unusual ways of doing this, and I'd like to show you a video.
It's ready.
Is it ready? Okay. I'd like to show you a video from a mobile screening there. In Congo, we do mobile screenings for thousands of people, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000, 6,000 people at a time. And I'd like to show you one of those mobile screenings, showing a film that was made by some Dutch filmmakers about our work with the military and our work generally to bring to the attention of authorities and to work with different sectors through the use of the media, through comic books, through radio soap operas, through television, through posters, through a range of other ways, bringing the attention to what's happening and transforming it. The work with the military is particularly significant in that most NGOs are working against the military because the military has been at the core of this and we all know it. And we made the decision that we needed to work with them. A major in military intelligence came to one of our workshops. He decided that he wanted to work to transform his own military and he joined us and others have followed. And so we have former members of the military working with the military to transform them. In the Kivus, we did a survey. We've been working with one of the battalions for a couple of years, and the survey showed that 90% of the people in that area said that there had been a reduction in crime, in assault, in rape, in corruption, and that if President Kabila wants to keep peace here, he better keep this battalion here. We don't want them to go, and if they do go, we're going to follow them anyway. Because they said, we feel safer now. Not, you know, it's not 100%, but we feel safer now than we've ever felt before. So we've now worked with 25% of the Congolese military, and we continue to do so. Here's the video.
Today, the organization has grown to 39 offices in 27 countries. The largest program is in the Congo, where SEARCH leads a countrywide effort to prevent sexual violence.
Sababu tuna maulizo ili tuwe na hakika kwamba umesikia yale ambayo tulikuwa na nia ya kuwafunga.
Nijiforce sana kwa kuforuka wa militeo.
SEARCH for Common Ground is educating the army, battalion by battalion. The results are remarkable. In South Kivu province, after SEARCH retrained an entire brigade, 92% of the people surveyed said the abuses were significantly reduced.
And we're also working in another way. We discovered, our team on the ground discovered that there were no positive role models for men, and there was all this attack on men, but no positive role models. And so we began to make a series of 8 spots so far, which are called Are You a Real Man? And they show scenes in which we expect one thing to happen, but something else does. So the first one that we're going to show. Can I see which is the first that's coming up? Okay. No. So the yeah. So the first one is a woman is being interviewed for a job, and this is what happens. Yes.
Allô? Tu es où?
Je suis en route, j'arrive.
Ok. Voici Rose, notre dernière candidate. Et Rose, voici tes évaluateurs.
He's a very famous rapper. And the second one takes place in a field, in a village.
Let me just say, the way you get a woman gets a job traditionally in the DRC is by men demand sex in return, and that's what that was playing on, just in case that was missed.
Well, not all men and not all women. And so the second one is self-explanatory too, and very moving.
Merci, papa.
De rien, maman.
Ça va, hein, non?
Est-ce que vous avez joué?
So what we're doing with these is shifting the archetype. I mean, we're working at that level. We did this with heroes in Burundi, where we shifted from heroes being those who went out and killed to those who saved the lives of others. And I love these. I think they're extraordinary. We had a little bit of an argument about whether to show them. I wanted to show them to you. I think it's so important to work. He's just a boy. I think it's so important for us to work with women and men and with men and women in this world as we all struggle to find our way. Oh, now the learning that we have been doing over, we've been codifying our learning. We have principles we have principles of how we do our work operationally. We have our core principles. We have our toolbox. And one of the things that John has done is pull together the principles of social entrepreneurship. And the point that I want to make about saying this is that all of this comes from our work, our daily work in the field. We don't sit here and say, oh, these should be our principles. What happens is, over the years, over the 30 years, we've stopped and we said, well, what actually happened here? What is this? And so we've gathered them, and they change all the time. We were talking to Paul, who came to our workshop in Esalen, about the principles and saying, well, next year there'll be a sort of a slightly different list, because it's always changing. We're always discovering something more. And so these are living lists, they're organic lists. And John is going to say a little bit about social entrepreneurship.
Yeah, I'm going to just start by telling you a line that I think came from Bernard Baruch, but I've never been able to find the origin of it, so I'm going to say allegedly, but or reportedly or reputedly. But he said, we know it works in practice, now let's figure out the theory. And that's a way of working that we use. That's how we do our work. We have developed over the years, from our own experience and from our own work, our ways and our principles, and they're pretty simple. I mean, we could do it. I'm going to run through basic principles in about 5 minutes. It's not rocket science. It's in many ways common sense. And usually, if there's social entrepreneurs in the audience, they'll say, "Yeah, no, I knew that." But having the distinction, knowing that that's a way, or there's actually a cliche. And these things do become a cliche in our organization, and people throw them back and they make bad puns, but it's a way we internalize them as an organization. And the first one of these principles, and incidentally, Paul came for a three-day workshop in these, and we can do a three-day version for you. I can do it in 2 hours, and right now I'm going to do it in 5 minutes.
We only have 5 minutes left altogether.
So the first principle of our work is start from vision. Know what your vision is, be clear on your vision, and everything should be consistent with your vision, or at least not inconsistent with your vision. Very simple. The second principle is be an applied visionary. You don't have to be an applied visionary, but if you want to make things happen in the world, you do have to be an applied visionary. In other words, that's the origin of being a social entrepreneur, finding ways to move from A to B to C to D, and we try to be incrementally transformational or transformationally incremental. I never get it right with you. It's probably both. There is an operating principle here, which I take from Napoleon, who doesn't get quoted enough in academic settings these days, because he was a major war criminal. Most people have forgotten that. In any case, he said, "On s'engage, puis on voit," which means in French, one becomes engaged, and then you see what the possibilities are. Now, that engagement probably needs to include reflective practice, but it's very much part of it. You, at least the work that we do, the way it's done is not to operate from basic learning, or though we try to get that learning. We want to have all the skills, we want to have the knowledge, we want to have the background in it, but you engage and you see where you're going. And if you're coming from a place that is a place that's kind of in the right place, then the place you're going to wind up is going to be pretty good too. But you don't know where you're going when you go into a conflict, and you don't know the way you are going to get out of it or move through it or whatever. And we have a toolbox, and we have a lot of ideas, and we have a lot of experience, and we use that. But that gets you maybe 50% of what you need. We say that 50% of our toolbox works when we move from country to country, and we never know which 50%. And so, you know, things, there's some things that hold, and there's some things that don't hold. And you just better be aware of that. The one that I'm going to go, which I I wouldn't have started with in an academic institution is, you might want to try practicing Aikido. And by that I mean political Aikido or personal Aikido. Aikido being a martial art, a Japanese martial art, but it's different than some of the other martial arts. In boxing, if a attacker comes at you, you go bop. And what you try to do is reverse their energy flow by 180 degrees and knock them back on their rear end. That's boxing. And there are lots of different ways to do it. You could undercut, you could do a hook, you could do a down punch, but essentially you're reversing their energy by 180 degrees. In Aikido, if an attacker comes at you, you accept their energy and you blend with their energy. You change it, the flow by 5 degrees or 10 degrees to find a way to make both of you safe. And that's probably the physical manifestation of conflict resolution. It's the physical metaphor for what we do. And when we sent the wrestlers to Iran, we were practicing Aikido. I would have liked to have stopped the conflict. That little approach didn't work very well. But we were able to create an opening, and you want to create a big enough opening that things really can change. But I don't have the power, and probably none of you have the power, to stop or make things stop automatically. We have the power not to shift things by 180 degrees, but 5 degrees or 10 degrees. But what I'm saying is be transformationally incremental about it. Don't just shift it, but have a sense of where it's going. If you want to send a ping pong team to China, you know, every once in a while you'll do it and things will change. And the last one.
I'm sorry, I thought you were turning.
Oh. I'm trying to take the microphone away from you.
So. Again.
Yes. Anyway, I actually mentioned the last one, which was the Woody Allen approach. Keep 80% of success is showing up. I would mix that with chutzpah. Keep moving forward. And when I say that, the metaphor I like there is of the toy truck. You know, the one that you wind up, and when it comes to a piece of furniture, it doesn't try to knock over the furniture, the chair. What it does is it backs up and goes around or finds a way through a path. And that's how we have to do our work. And that's why you have to be incredibly adaptive. And that's why the principles that you start with need to be, or at least the operating principles, need to be adjusted as you go and you keep inventing new ones. I was in Bahrain yesterday, came in this last night. And let me just say, doing our work in Bahrain is not like the cycle DRC, just very different. And I had to make a lot of adaptations very quickly. But en s'engage, puis en voie, one becomes engaged and one sees. So, thus concludes my remarks.
I would like to end with some music. We just know music as this great transformational energy and essence in our world. It reaches directly into our hearts. Here is the Middle East peace song, which we made with that series that we talked about in the beginning that John produced. And it's in Arabic and in Hebrew. The singers, two very famous singers from each side, could never be in the studio together. We had to film them separately.
No.
They
couldn't be in the same frames.
They couldn't be in the same.
Together.
Yeah, they couldn't be. We couldn't show them together, is what I'm trying to say. And so here they are with this blended piece of music to end our evening of our remarks as we move on. And we just have to show you.
Bonnet et toi.
Thank you both so much. I am really pleased now to ask Mark Thurston to make some remarks, open discussion. But first, I have to tell people who you are, Mark. Mark's a good friend and senior fellow with the Center for Consciousness and Transformation and with the Center for Peacemaking Practice. And he's worked for many decades in adult education related to consciousness, holistic health, personal transformation. Author of numerous books related to personal spirituality, dream psychology, meditation, transformation of consciousness, will.
Thank you. Thank you all for that lovely presentation. Very inspiring, really. When we began the Center for Consciousness and Transformation 3.5 years ago here at George Mason, I think an evening like this evening is just what we had in mind. Mm-hmm. And so it's really inspiring to us, and certainly renews the vision that we had in starting our center. I wanted to make just a few comments to reflect on some of the things I heard over the last hour and a half. And then my main role over these next 20 minutes is to facilitate some conversation, both with the Marks, and I hope also the people, the three of you who made comments at the beginning, could be part of that conversation, and questions might be directed to you as well. Anne used a lovely image of the sort of creative tension between imagination and engagement. And I think if we were going to rename our center 3.5 years ago, maybe it should have been the Center for Imagination and Engagement rather than Consciousness and Transformation. Because I think that those words are right at the heart of what we're trying to do. And I think I can speak for the other three organizations as well that are co-sponsors. That image was especially a powerful way to begin this evening. And Andrea used the word framing. And it came up again in John's comments as well. And I've been using that word in some of my classes, undergraduate classes, and talking about how we usually think of framing as sort of the border that goes around something, or sort of the what way of sort of putting a description around something that would shape how we see it. But there's another way that the word framing is used in English. It's like a carpenter who's building a house or a home, who's kind of framing that is the very architecture of the shape internally of the matter. And I think what we're trying to do at our center is especially work with how we reframe internally in terms of giving people the opportunity to reflect on the structures of meaning that actually give the shape to their life and their work and their creativity and their community. So I think that word is especially important that we continue to create around the meaning of framing. And Greg, I was very touched with the way you're talking about working with students and being able to find students who have a fierce kind of idealism, but are also ready to make that applied idealism and really be out in the world doing things. And so for our undergraduate minor that we have at the Fairfax campus, that includes CAR students, SCAR has an undergraduate branch at the Fairfax campus, but we have students from all over the university that are doing our undergraduate minor in consciousness and transformation. And the capstone course to that minor is consciousness and transformation in action. And it's really seeking to do just what I think you're trying to do with the social entrepreneurship, the new graduate degree, of how do we marry that kind of idealism with a readiness and even a willingness to be out in the world and to put this into action. So just last year, we had a faculty learning community sponsored by our center in which we had 14 different faculty members working on either developing a brand new course or retrofitting an old course to bring contemplative practice and reflection and mindfulness into the curriculum, either the pedagogy or the content of the course. And so we had courses like a trauma counseling course developed and another one on conservation science and spirituality. Susan was retrofitting a course here at SCAR on reflective practice. My wife, Mary Elizabeth, was developing a new course on intuitive reasoning. So we had 14 courses emerge out of this faculty learning community. And that's the kind of model of what our center is trying to do, working with faculty across the campus. I also love this phrase of applied transformationalists, or applied transformationalism. And when we were just starting our center, I spoke with a business consultant who was actually here on campus working with the Board of Visitors, and he asked me if I could say in 7 words what our center was about. And you know, you gotta think on your feet really fast sometimes. And what I came up with was change your mind, transform the world, in terms of what I thought our center was. But I loved what you said today about change your mindset, change your heart, which in turn allows you to change your mindset more fully and then to change your heart more deeply and so forth. And I think it's that change of heart that was missing from what I said to him that day. I might ask him for 8 or 9 words instead of just 7 so I could find some way of bringing that heartfulness into it, that wholeheartedness. Because as I'm working with students, as I'm working with colleagues or events like this that engage the community, I think it's this change of heart that is maybe new to a university, or it's not traditional to a university. And so a part of what all, I think all 4 of these organizations that are co-sponsoring tonight are really committed to both a change of mindset and a changing of heart so that we can be transformationalists in this applied way. So before I open it to questions, if I can make a pitch for our undergraduate minor in consciousness and transformation. There's a little blue handout on the table as you exit later. And then one more pitch, right, Brandis, for our conference on April 13th, which is on resilience. And I think resilience is an important topic in several ways, especially around self-care. And those of us that are out in the world trying where the rubber meets the road to make these things culturally impactful need to discover our own resilience, sort of in the spirit of self-care, and also understand more deeply the resilience of people that we're working with, no matter what conditions those may be, that the human spirit is profoundly resilient, and this conference is largely around how we can understand that from both a research and an application frame of reference. And so it's Friday the 13th in April. It's at the Mason Inn, which is a fabulous place to hold a conference. Undergraduate students can come to the whole day for $25, graduate students for $50. I guess we're extending that early bird price until March 19th. And please consider being a part of this spring conference that we do, again, on an annual basis. And with that commercial, I want to throw it open to comments or questions, and I'll just try to be the facilitator here. And hopefully these mics are live also. And maybe I can start using this one and we can pass this one around. Who has the first comment or a question to present to the marks or to one of the 3 commentators from the beginning? Please identify yourself as you do.
Hi, my name is Andrea Bartoli. I'm Greg Stanton, work here at ESCAR. I've known the Marks, goodness knows how many years, from the first meeting, I think, of the Burundi Policy Forum, back about 1994 or so. I wanted to ask you to describe the work that you began in Burundi and what it has accomplished there.
We went into Burundi right after the genocide in Rwanda. And we went in because a friend of mine named Lionel Rosenblatt issued a challenge to people. There had been these awful events going on in Rwanda, and next door was Burundi, which seemed on the verge of the same kinds of things. There were thousands of people being killed every month, but it wasn't yet after genocide. And Lionel said to me, we'd been in a meeting on Burundi. He said, you say you're a conflict resolution organization. What good are you if you can't do Burundi? He was right. And about a month later, Susan and me and Lionel were on a plane and we went to Burundi. Now we did our homework and we got our auspices and we got the UN involved and everything else. But by the time we were through, we did what I would call societal mediation or societal conflict resolution in Burundi. We found that working in a multi-pronged basis, in other words, lots of things at the same time, was more effective than one thing at the time. In our field, there had been a tendency to do a workshop or a training and then to stop or to keep that going. But we started a radio studio, which had Hutu and Tutsi journalists, and at its peak, it was doing 15 hours a week of radio broadcasts to bring people back together. We started a women's peace center, which was empowering women as peacemakers and working literally with thousands of women's associations around the country. And the idea was that women could play a real strong role in preventing violence, genocide, conflict, and the like. We used a lot of music. We had a national drumming contest. Drumming is the way that you do culture in a place in Burundi. We worked a lot with youth. We used to call it the Working with Killers program, until I was told that wasn't the best way to raise money. Maybe we made it into the Burundi Youth Project or something like that. But they were young people who had blood on their hands. And we did a lot of these things, and we benefited from the fact that most of the NGOs were pulling out, and there was a coup d'etat during that period, and it meant that that because U.S. government has a regulation that if there's a coup, you have to cut off aid, and we got an exception, a presidential exception, through a networking connection. We happened to Brian Atwood, who was the head of aid, was an old friend of mine, and he got us that exception. He said, look, now more than ever, what we're doing is needed. This is not the time to pull out, it's the time to increase these kinds of activities. And we were doing the bottom-up sorts of things. The top-down was being done by South Africa and Mandela personally, and they were running a process to bring the government leaders and high-level people together. And that combination of bottom-up and top-down is what made it work, it seems to me. You need both, it's not either or. We were creating an environment or a climate or a context, we were reframing in the country, and they were negotiating. And those two things, I think, had a pretty profound impact on what happened in Burundi. And people said afterwards, it's hard to evaluate this because you never know what would have happened if you hadn't done it. It's like trying to prove a negative. And it's one of the problems with this whole field of monitoring and evaluation is it's hard to get the right indicators and elements in here. And nobody's really solved this problem. We have lots of ways we claim to solve this problem. And but what I'm saying is it was a really, we felt, an important thing, and other observers were saying it worked very well. The evaluations also came out very well.
How was your question?
I'm Arsen Kharazian, and I'm a graduate student here at ESCAR. Thank you so much for very rich and a great presentation. Actually, it's funny, I was at a peace conference in Italy in 2009 where an Israeli and Palestinian women singers just traveled from Moscow from the Eurovision Song Contest and actually sang for us. This was a big conference of organized by the Italian government for the people of Caucasus, over 150 people. And what that says is the comment that you made about the small video that you showed, that the two males decided not to be in the same scene. They were singing together on the stage of the world's pop, whatever spot, making a political statement by that. And I think that as many more women will be and are involved in conflict resolution and our analysis, the better we're going to be off. This is just a comment about the video. My question will be a little more specific. You talked about the Italian-American group and an issue that comes up with any dialogue, I think, when the two sides grow together throughout the days, basically transforming and having a lot of different changes throughout the dialogue. And then at the end of the discussion, they are completely different and going back to their constituencies, they don't know what to do. And here is the biggest dilemma that anybody who does and has been involved in dialogues has. I would highly appreciate, and I'm an Armenian who has a lot of conflicts around, has been marginalized from his own societies at different points, being too friendly to the enemy, and had friends who have been doing the same thing on the from the other side. The question is more about what are your experiences, how you actually create some safe ground for the people who have the courage to get involved in dialogues, not only in dialogues, but actually becoming the multipliers going back to their societies. If you have ways of basically satisfying their or creating space for them to feel more secure after they're involved in this. And what are your experiences on this once people go back and have to actually live in their own societies where the perceptions and stereotypes are still in play?
You know, it takes a lot of courage to engage in dialogue when you're in conflict. Remember George Bush said, if you're not with us, you're against us. And that's generally what happens in conflict. There's that in violent conflict, that deep sense of that division, and the courage is enormous. In South Africa, people who engaged in conflict were killed, engaged in dialogue were killed at times because of this. So it's in itself, the first part of the answer is that courageous people are the ones who are a part of the dialogue. And I believe that this work is heroic, that the people who come and engage are heroic, because it is a very big step to take, to step out of the norm of just we getting along with our lives and move into this place of saying, I stand for something different. And it's the thing that inspires me always in my work with all the downs of the world and of conflict, which we all experience. The optimism that I have, which is always there, comes from those people who I'm so inspired by, who are willing to say, I'm not going to be pulled into being with us or against us. I'm going to stand for something different and for a new kind of future. So often there's not an enormous amount that you can do because people are self-selecting to come to this kind of dialogue. However, what we do is we prepare people as best we can, by having the conversation, by ensuring that they are aware of what they may go back to. In some cases, people need to keep very quiet about it. We've been facilitating a lot between Palestinians and Israelis, and one Palestinian's family still thinks he goes to pharmaceutical conferences. He's a pharmacist. And that's how it has to be with his family. The other thing is, of course, for people who are engaged in the conflict from one side or the other to stay connected together, but also to keep the connection going with the group. And that's an important part for the participants who choose this to be inspired themselves, to have their courage boosted. You know, we need to support that deeply. And we need to be there at the end of a phone, at the end of Skype, at the end of of some way of connecting. One of the things that we've been building in recent years into our work is coaching, personal coaching with the people that we work with, whereby there is a one-on-one conversation where anything can be raised. And where we're often dealing with leadership, when we were doing our leadership work, it's specifically around that. But when we're doing our leadership work, for instance, between Palestinians and Israelis, which we have an ongoing program with emerging leaders, they all get coaching. And that's a form of them, of really each individual finding themselves, refinding themselves, in taking themselves and bringing the highest and greatest expression of that self, and in the process, growing their own courage. So there aren't really easy answers to this. We just keep on keeping on, and we hope that we learn along the way. You know, none of us really know that much about all of this. We're just trying, we're just discovering. We're a very big organization with all these hundreds of people doing this work, you know, full-time, let alone all the others who are on. I love the fact that we called Search for Common Ground, because we're always searching. It's at the core of who we are, is that this is an ongoing search, that it's an ongoing growth. And our personal growth, I think, is one of the biggest gifts that this work gives us. My life has been completely transformed by doing this work over the last few decades. I can't imagine what it would have been like, but I know it would have been, I would be less if I had not been exposed to the extraordinary people that I have met along the way and walked this path with. So I can't really give too helpful an answer, but those are some thoughts.
Maybe time for just one more. We're almost at 9:30, believe it or not.
My question is to Susan, and the most touching movie was when the woman from Kenya, when she lost her child and went back. That really moved me, because even my family went through a lot. But I've been a practitioner for almost 10 years in the field, and I came here, and my conflict has always been the two sides, like one the oppressed and one the most powerful. And here what I've seen is mostly a space for common ground, but in certain conflicts there has been a space yet for two groups to come together. And I came across a woman from who lost her own son, where she had all her hopes on him. And she started crying when she narrated to me her story, and I didn't know what to tell her, because she hasn't got that space where the powerful had to come and confess to her. And in such a situation, what do we do about it? And yeah, I need your feedback on that.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think the most powerful thing we can do as healers, which in the end is what we're doing, healing means making whole. It means going into the places where there has been a tearing and a breaking, and working to bring that back into wholeness. And that's what we do as in our work in conflict. And one of the most powerful things that we can do is just be present, bring our presence. We can't solve other people's problems. At a very personal level, we can be present with people, we can listen. We can't come up with answers. And the healing power of presence is enormous. And as I stand and look at you, and I see the calm in you, I believe that your calm and your calm presence, not even necessarily with words, can be a huge force and powerful place for the healing of the people around you. Never ever underestimate that. None of us ever underestimate your willingness to just be with people in their time and place of pain. Because remember, what conflict does is it just creates, violent conflict creates pain for everybody. And that's why we have to end it.
Thank you all very much. So perhaps there's a chance to meet them if you didn't get a chance to shake hands or say hi. And we want to thank you again for taking the time out on a busy Tuesday.
Thank you so much. Thank you for your presence tonight. Thank you, everybody.
Thanks for being here.